Welcome again, my brothers and sisters, to this our another midweek Bible study as we continue our study in the book of Hebrews. And it has been a very interesting journey. Trust that you are following and that you are being inspired to explore the book of Hebrews. It's really, when contrast with Old Testament writings and practices, especially under the Levitical priesthood, we see how deficient the Old Testament sacrifice was and how efficient the New Testament sacrifice is, because it's a once and for all sacrifice. So we want to welcome you in that spirit. Welcome our brothers and sisters here from the Barrett and the Mount Zion and Farmites congregations, and trust that as we share today, God will truly inspire you and bless you and enrich your heart with the word of God. And since we are talking about Christ as the high priest, I want to use this song, "We Place You at the Highest Place." Very nice chorus that we can share. Father, we just bless you today because you're God and you're God above all other gods. We celebrate your greatness. You invite us through the sacrificial Christ, this exalted Christ, that we should come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may find mercy and grace to help in the time of need. It is on the basis of that we come. We come like children. We come without timidity. We come because the veil of the temple rented in twain at the crucifixion of your Son Jesus Christ, and you have given us access right into your presence, a privilege that was given only to the high priest of old. You have now given to all of us, because you declare in your word that we are a chosen generation. We are a royal priesthood. We are a holy nation called out from the world to show forth your praises. And even as we gather, we are conscious of the many hurting people across the globe. O God Almighty, we are conscious of the challenges, those who are tested, those who are disenfranchised, those who are afflicted. We bring them to you, God. We bring all our members to you who are confined to their homes because they are physically challenged in one way or another. Those in the Mount Zion Charge, Lilliput, Barrettown, those in the Farmites Congregation, we commit them to you. And, O God, we commit those in our country to you, our members, those who are hurting, those who are jobless. We commit those who are sick to you, O God. We make a special mention of Miss Box, who has an eye condition. We speak to that situation, O God, right now, in the name of Jesus Christ. And we speak healing into her body. Romario in the Falmouth Hospital. We speak also to Omari's situation in the Farmites Congregation, has just lost his father, that it will bring him strength and comfort in this time. We speak, O God, to the situation of my brother in Canada, who has lost a son in the state. Pray that God, in the name of Jesus Christ, you'll bring comfort to him and all the family members and friends and relatives. We pray for those in India, for those, O God Almighty, in the Caribbean, for those in the North America, Europe, that you will grant them your grace. We pray for a transformation, O God, of our country and our economy, and that, Lord, you push back on the situation here, the COVID virus situation. We pray that there will continue to be a dip in the numbers in the name of Jesus Christ, and things will return to normalcy. Bless your word to our hearts today as we share. In Christ's name we pray. Brothers and sisters, Christ is exalted above all our situation. We celebrate the fact that God has highly exalted him and given him a name above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Let us move into the Word of God today, ancient Word of God, as we trust him to minister to us. Yes, brothers and sisters, ancient words. At this time, we are going to turn to, right down to Hebrews 10. Hebrews 10. I was hoping that we'd be able to complete this entire chapter today, but obviously not. So let us look and see how much of it we can complete. I think we'll maybe just read verse 1 to verse 18, and then all things being equal, God willing, we will look at the rest of the chapter from verse 19 to verse 39 in our next go. So, here we go. For the law having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can ever with those sacrifices which they offered, year by year continually, make the comers thereunto perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because that the worshippers once purged should have had no more conscience of sins. But in those sacrifices there is a remembrance again made of sins every year. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. Wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he saith, Sacrifice and offerings thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I, Lo, I come in the volume of the book, it is written of me, to do thy will, O God. Above, when he said, Sacrifice and offering, and burnt offering, and offering for sin thou wouldest not, neither had pleasure therein, which are offered by the law. Then said he, Lo, I come to do thy will, O God. He taketh away the first, that he may establish the second, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ, once and for all. And every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifice which can never take away sins. But this man, after he offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. For by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. Whereof the Holy Ghost also is a witness to us. For after that he had said before, This is the covenant that I will make with them. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And after their sins, and iniquities, will I remember no more. Now, where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. This is the word of the Lord. God, may you bless us. Add your richest blessing to your word. We keep saying from the last chapter 8-9 that the writer, brothers and sisters, reaches the pinnacle of his argument. Remember now that he's out to establish Christ as the superior mediator of God to humankind. And so here in chapter 10 of the book, the writer continues to advance his argument about the superiority of the new covenant to the old. At this time, join and making contrast of the new covenant with the old. As indicated before, the writer now reaches the climax of his discourse on the argument. He's trying to prove in relation to the superiority of the new covenant over the old. he now brings to conclusion the contrast he was always making and has advanced in this chapter. The advance between the Levitical, the superiority of the priesthood of Christ to the Levitical priesthood. In chapter 8, verse 1 to 6, he argued that the new covenant operates in a better scene, and in that the priesthood of Christ under the new covenant operated in a scene that is heavenly, while the first, or the priesthood of Aaron, operated in a scene that is earthly and is a tabernacle made with human hands and is a replication of the heavenly one, a shadow of the real thing. The new is under better conditions though, since it is a covenant of grace rather than a covenant of works. And I think this is the essence of what Paul is saying, that it is not by the works of righteousness that any man should boast, but by grace are we saved through faith. And the grace of God, brothers and sisters, which is the unmerited favor, allows for the scope of mercy. In other words, what I'm saying is that when you sin under the old covenant, you'd have been stoned to death. But in and under the new covenant, we are encouraged to come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may find mercy and grace to help in the time of need. Under the old covenant, the weakness is shown in the fact that though the high priest had the opportunity to enter the holiest of all on the Day of Atonement by virtue of the sacrifice he offered, it was limited in scope. And these are some of the ways in which it was limited. One, the high priest was the only one who could enter and gain access to the divine presence of God. The rest of the priests would have to tarry and linger in the holy place or in the outer court as they did their daily administration. So the rest of the priesthood could not enter, much more the people of Israel. So that made it limited. Under the new covenant, all can enter, because the veil of the temple is torn down and all of God's children as priests and kings can enter the holiest of all. We don't need a priest to mediate between us and God here. Only the high priest Jesus, the great high priest Jesus Christ, who is in the heavenly, making intercession for us. Secondly, he could not enter God's presence daily, but only once every year. Brothers and sisters, wherever you are, you can just engage in worship and immediately you can be ushered in the presence of God, where the Bible says in his presence there are fullness of joy and at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. So only the priest could be ushered in the presence of God, and he would enter just once every year. We can go anytime into the presence of God, coming boldly to the throne of grace without even anybody knowing, without even having to ask permission, without even have to leave our location. We can just go into God's presence. Jesus' presence is greater than Zoom and Google Meet, because we don't have to go anywhere to go into his presence. We just call him up wherever we are, and God is present. The fact also, brothers and sisters, that there was a veil and places limitation on the people themselves. The very ritual shown that showed that full access to God was not yet made possible, right? So the fact that they have to be repeating the process day by day, and on the Day of Atonement every year is a sign that true access to God, even though the priest could go, was still not made possible. In contrast, it is only through Christ that such access to God has been secured. The sacrifice of Christ, unlike the sacrifice of the old ritual, was abiding in its efficacy or in its ability to produce. It needs not be repeated. So Christ did not have to come and offer himself over and over. It was potent. The sacrifice Christ offered was adequate, it was efficacious, and it was sufficient so that we could be rescued. Chapter 9 and verse 25 to 26 says, "Nor yet that he should offer himself often, as the high priest entered into the holy place every year with blood of others." Verse 26 says, "For then must he often had suffered since the foundation of the world, but now once in the end of the world, as he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself." And I think what the writer meant, that he was suffering from the foundation of the world, is the essence of what I think John himself said when John says, "Saw the Lamb of God coming," and he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world." And in one other place of the epistles, it said, "Is the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world? For we were not redeemed," the Bible says, "with corruptible things as silver and gold," Peter, "but with the precious blood of God, as like a lamb slain from the foundation of the world." But in the end, the Bible says, now he comes and he made this once and for all sacrifice, and he put an end to sin, an end to the Levitical priesthood, and the repetition of having to go. You know, when I thought of the Old Testament practices, brothers and sisters, it must have been a very bloody altar to have everything sprinkled by blood. The Bible says everything had to be sprinkled by blood. The vessels, the altar, Aaron, the priest, everybody. It was a bloody place, and it must have been a smelly place too. It must have been an uncomfortable place to be. But that was the only place available to create an atonement for human sins. The writer now expands the idea and establishes the truth that the Jewish sacrificial system, was only able to offer types of the true spiritual realities. So it could not, by its act of repetition or repeated sacrifices, secure complete salvation for those who participate in it. According to chapter 10 and verse 1 of the chapter 10 that we are in, it says, "For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, could ever, with the sacrifices which they offered year by year continually, made the comers thereof perfect." The sacrifices could not make the comers perfect. The writer's point was that the very repetition of these sacrifices were proof that the ancient ritual could not effect the atonement that was necessary to secure eternal salvation, for it was a shadow. The fact that they had to repeat it, the fact that it was a replication of the heavenly tabernacle, and it had to be repeated, it's a sign of the inadequacy of it, and that it was incapable of producing the kind of result that God intended originally, that it could not produce salvation and bring back humankind in right relationship with God. The very repetition of the sacrifices were proof that they could not secure the desired results. Otherwise, would they not cease them? If they were capable, if they were efficient, if they were able to produce the desired result, brothers and sisters, it would still be in operation, but they could not. Verse 2 to 4 says to us from the text, same Hebrews 10, for then would they not have ceased to be offered because that the worshippers once purged should have no more conscience for sin. But you see, the Old Testament sacrifices didn't wash away sins. The blood did not wash away sins. They only covered the sins, creating a covering to protect the people from God's wrath. But the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses the very conscience and washes away the sins. And this is why the songwriter caught the vision and says, Are you washed in the cleansing blood of the Lamb? Verse 3 says, for in these sacrifices, there is a remembrance of sins made again every year. So what he's saying is that if you had committed adultery, for instance, or you're a thief, or anything like that, and you went and offered a sacrifice for that sin, coming next year, you have to repeat the process, and you would be remembered of the sin that you have committed before. But under the new covenant, God took away our yesterday and led us free from sin. And in the home of glory, he will never mention them. In a deep sea call, forget the all sail. Brothers and sisters, God took away our yesterday, the moment that we met. So verse 3 says, for in those sacrifices, there is a remembrance of sins made again every year. Under the new covenant, there is no memory of it. God, wipe your slate clean. Thank God for Jesus. Verse 4 says, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and of goats should take away sins. Yes, it could create an atonement. And the goat had to be of a special kind. Spotless, first from the matrix, and so on and so forth. But it could not take away sin. The inadequacy of the animal sacrifice made necessary a new offering, namely the self-sacrifice of Christ. The writer then, in verse 5 to 7, uses a quotation from Psalm 40, verse 6 to 8. He's always quoting from the Old Testament and reminiscing the text. So he uses a quotation from Psalm 40, verse 6 to 8, to buttress and to shore up, his point. He says, sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears have thou opened. Burnt offering and sin offering hast thou not required. In other words, God had no pleasure in them. Verse 7 says, then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book it is written of me. I delight to do your will, O God. Yes, your law is written in my heart. And verse 8 seeks to expound on what verse 6 to 8 is saying. Verse 6 to 7, 5 to 7 is saying. It is saying in verse 8, it says, when he said, sacrifice and offering and burnt offering and offering for sin thou wouldest not, neither had pleasure in them which offered by the law. In other words, because they were offered under the law, God had no pleasure in them. And in other words, they could not continue. The term when was offered by the law would give the impression that because they were offered by the law and under the law, God had no pleasure in them. The conclusion is therefore reach that the self-sacrifice of Christ in submission to God's will is far better than all burnt offerings and sacrifices for sin. And by Christ's self-sacrifice, he was actually fulfilling what God originally intended, which would be God's will, to create an opportunity for humankind to have full access to him. Wow. So the conclusion, as I said then, is that the Mosaic sacrifices have been supplanted by the sacrifice of Christ. God, through Christ, took away the old so that he could establish the new. According to verse 9, this was the will of God, that the old would be done away with so that he could establish the new. Verse 9 says, then said he, lo, I come to do thy will, O God. And the will of God was to take away the first so that he could establish the second, because he found out that it was very much inadequate. It was a bridge. It was like a kind of pseudo type practice. It was just to put a makeshift one. But under the coming of Christ, Christ established something new that is far superior and that is better, that we can live with and that can create eternal life for us. In verse 10 of the text, it says, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Yes, he didn't have to repeat it once and for all. He did it once and he did it for all the entire world. The weakness in the Old Testament sacrifice is manifested in the fact that they had to be repeated daily and every year. Christ's sacrifice was once and for all, and it fulfilled God's original intention and effected the desired result. It accomplished God's will. The sacrifice of Christ then is final, and such finality is seen in the fact that while the high priest of old would be standing daily and repeating this the same sacrifice again and again, they were standing daily, repeating the same sacrifice again every day and every year, Christ offered himself once and for all. The finality of his work is seen in the fact that he is no longer standing in a temple ministering, but is now seated in his place of supreme power, making intercession for us. When your task is completed, brothers and sisters, isn't that what you do? You sit down and you relax. In other words, under the old system, there was no rest for the Levitical priesthood. Every day, all through the year, and every year, Christ did a once and for all sacrifice, and he sit down at the right hand of his Father. I think it's the same thing the writer of Philippians is saying, oh God, I highly exalt Christ, who thought it a robbery to be equal with the Father, made himself of no reputation and took upon himself the form of a servant, even to the death of the cross, became humble even to the death of the cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and tongue confess that he is Lord. In verse 11 to 13, and every priest standeth daily ministering and offering oftentimes the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. And verse 12 says, but this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God the Father. Verse 13 says, from henceforth expecting till his enemies be made his footstool. In other words, I think he's talking about the end of time, when he decides to rise again and maybe come for the millennium reign, and he would destroy the Antichrist, and he would take over, put an end to the tribulation period, and he would reign for 1,000 years with his saints. For until such time when he comes to bring judgment, until such time when he comes to rid the earth of all the wicked and corruption, he sit down at his Father, making intercession for the saints. In verse 14, for by one sacrifice he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. Oh, brothers and sisters, thus there is power in the blood of Jesus Christ to revolutionize your life, to set you free, and to make you complete in yourself. Those who are broken and trodden down by the power of this sacrifice of Christ, we can be restored, made perfect, made whole through the sacrificial act of Jesus Christ. The writer then, as he did in chapter 8, quoted from Jeremiah 31 verse 33 to 34, which refers to the spiritual nature of the new covenant that is mediated for us through Jesus Christ. And so we see him quoting, and is then listed in verse 15 to 17, saying, whereof the Holy Ghost is also witness to us. For after that he had said before, this is the new covenant that I will make with them. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts and in their minds, and I will write them in their hearts and in their minds. In other words, this time the covenant will not be on tables of stones, as we said last week, but this time it will be written upon the hearts of those who come to him. Verse 17 says, and their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. In other words, we referred to that briefly a while ago, that God will through his grace and mercy blot out all our transgressions. In verse 18, the writer argues, in conclusion of the section we're dealing with, the writer argues that for the abiding efficacy of the work of Christ and the absolute finality of the Christian faith, he says that the work of Christ is efficacious, it is abiding, it is final. Yes, it is absolute. There is nothing else that can supersede it. It is capable, it is adequate, it is sufficient to produce the desired result of healing, deliverance, salvation, and securing eternal life for us. So it concludes that segment in verse 18 by saying, now we are remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Brothers and sisters, God bless you. Until next week, we continue with verse 19 to 39, as we will look at the fact that we should hold on to this new covenant, or the benefits of this new covenant. We should hold on to the faith that we have. We should not let it slip from us. We should not fall into apostasy. And we should also not neglecting the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, which is classified as willful sin. So we look forward to continuing next week, God willing, and that God grant us life, brothers and sisters. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Shalom, brothers and sisters.